Hey folks, I'm Vincent. Today we're going to play a bit of Expedition Viking, Game Biologic Artist. It is a new opus of the Expedition franchise. The previous title was Expedition Conquistador, I think. And in this one, we're going to play as a young Viking who has inherited the land of his father, who has presumably died in a raid on the British Islands. So, how is it working? It is fairly close to how a pretty classical CRPG would work, but with turn-based combat. There is also an extra layer of management for your town, as you are going to try to make it survive at first, and eventually thrive. And last but not the least, we've got a pretty strong and compelling storyline. It is very well written, and it is really putting you into the right ambience. So, I've been preparing a few saves, because this game which is fairly long, and we would not be able to see everything I want to show if we were to begin a new game. I'm still going to begin a new game, because I want to show you how we are going to customize our character, and the different skills which are going to be available, and all the thing. But I want to show you also a bit of combat with a team which is going to be a bit more advanced. And on the last one, we'll try to go and discover a bit of the British Islands. The thing is, I don't want to show you too much. I cannot say it's going to be spoiler-free, but I'm going to try to keep it to the minimum. Alright then, let's just make a new game and create a new character. So we've got a fairly basic character editor, but considering this game which is top-down view, I'm quite impressed by the quality of this character. It just looks stunning. The art style is really, really cool, and it's just fitting very well together. Plus, I like the fact that we've got three layers of color, which are going to enable us to make characters which are going to be easy to spot from afar, so you don't mix up a bowman with a shield bearer or something like that. So I'm going to randomize a bit so I can just show you a few more. And I will also show you a few more male character with birds and stuff, because Vikings without birds are not going to be Vikings after all. So we're going to just go for a few more. And what I find also very, very cool is that the portrait on the left are high quality and also very, very good. Plus, we are also going to be able to use these, or at least most of these I think, to make customized mercenaries. There is also going to be companions which are going to have a storyline, which are going to be predefined, but at some point we will be able to fill your team with also a customized character. You will be able to make these from the ground up, so if you want to make a dedicated bowman or a guy which is going to be very good with axe, it's definitely possible. Nonetheless, I'm going to create a character quickly, because we don't really care for this part, and plus I will just load my game a little bit later. But we're going to begin maybe with, let's just try to make that guy looking a little bit more like the picture here. So we're going to give him a medium body, we're going to also give him a shimmer look, we're going to give him a bird which are going to be breaded, let's just see, where was it, breaded, yes. We're going to go with a color which is going to be a slightly bit... where is that color? Maybe not, maybe a bit like that. We're going to remove the hair. Here we go, let's just go for the... let's see, is there a bald? Yes, there is a bald look, okay. We're going to change a bunch of things like the tunic. I'm going to go with something with... let's see. I think this one is going to be the one which is going to be the closest, kind of, maybe not. We have something with, yes, this one might be good as well. We're going to keep the arm bare. I'm going to just change the shoes. We've got wrappings, clothes, shoes, boots, or sandals. I'm going to go with the boots, I think, the boots, yes. And do we want to change the color? I'm going to go with something a bit, yes. Bit like that, so it might be good to begin with. I'm going to keep the names. It is important to notice that this is the name of your father, not your second name here, because you are going to be... He's important for the storyline. So I will be Vingsar, son of Valdar, on my other game, but on this one I will be... I'm going to make a lot of mistakes with the name, because there is plenty which are going to be very difficult for me to say, plus I don't know how these are going to read, so I will do mistakes. Maybe I should just choose something a little bit faster. Like, let's say, Belly, Blaine, Krankel, we have something, Ragnar, it is. Okay, it's a bit presumptuous here, but we're going to go with that. And we're going to also... we don't really care. Anyway, let's just go with that, and let's see what we can do with the skills. So we've got a pretty classical setup here. We've got stat points and skill points to spend. got 5 stats, which are going to be, let's say to simplify, important for 5 class, even though it's probably going to be a bit more than that. We've got Strength for Warrior, Endurance for Shield Bear, Finesse for Rogues, Perception for Bowman, and Sense for Cleric. These are not exactly Cleric, but it is the idea of it. But we've got a bunch more classes. If you go into Select Presets, if you don't want to bother making your own customized class, you've got also 9 presets which are going to be enabling you to have a little, let's say, sample of what you can do. I might even want to go for one of these so we can just gain a bit of time here. I'm not going to make a character which is going to be too customized, but we're going to go, let's say I'm going to go with Hunter here. It's going to spend all the points in a way which is going to make you efficient. You're not obligated to just go with that. If you want to customize a template, you can definitely do that. I can just remove a bunch of points in Perception and put a bit in Strength. If I want to be able to, let's say, use an axe, I'm going to be able to use an axe with 4 points of Strength, so it is important to pay attention to that. Plus, you cannot change these. You will not gain any point of stats as you're going to advance. You are going to gain skill points, but not stats. Stats is going to remain the same all the time. Nonetheless, we've got quite a bunch of skills, and these are really going to be the most important things, because it is going to be defining everything, kind of. So I'm going to go quickly through these skill categories. The first one is going to be about war, so you are going to be able to increase your efficiency with different kind of weapons here. You are going to be also able to unlock different kind of skills which are going to be linked to these categories. Then we've got an offensive skill stuff which is going to unlock special abilities like maybe stunning enemies, or let's say we can use also a cripple shot so we can prevent enemy from moving. Then we've got another category here which is going to be about, let's say, it is going to be about buff and healing. It's going to be the category which is going to be the most important for your cleric here. We've got also a utility skill tab, which is quite important because you are going to be obligated when you travel to make camps, and these things are going to help you quite a lot. I will explain that when we are going to make a camp, because it's going to be a lot easier that way. But it is a very important category here. And then the last one is going to be about passives. So we've got plenty of different passives which are going to help you in your fight. I'm not going to go in depth with this because there is so many, and plenty of these are really, really useful, but there is a lot of way to make your character stronger here. So let's just, I don't think we've got anything else to see here. No, let's just keep going. I think we should be good that way. We'll be able to assign the remaining bits of skill point later on. So I'm just going to show a little bit of the beginning. We're going to spoil a little bit, but not too much. Warrior and a good husband, but he was not a strong chieftain to his clan. As he travels to join his brothers in the halls of Valhalla, you must take his place. Our clan is beset by petty squabbles. Some amongst our people would contest your claim to leadership, as they saw discord our neighbor's plot against us. Gather your most trusted clansmen. Together you will face dangers which none can predict. You will be challenged on your leadership, your resolve, your wisdom. Build a ship and take your housecarls across the sea. Power and strength for our clan must be sought outside the Norselands. If you show yourself to be bold, the gods will follow you into battle. Your legacy will live for a thousand years beyond your time. Our clan must prevail. Absolutely love the voiceover. It's absolutely amazing. Alright. So we are going to begin this adventure at the funeral of our father. So every clansman are going to gather around here, and me, Odin, in my effort to bind the struggle of bygone time as glimmering light on glass. Okay, so here we begin. So it is evening after your father funeral. When you close your eye, the image of his blessing ship shimmers in the dark behind your eyelids. It's not a common ritual this far south, but your mother, Astrid, who hails from the lands of the Geat, insisted in it. All the Tain of the neighboring clans have come to attend your feast in his honor. Your father may not have been the most successful Tain, but as a warrior, he commanded the respect of many. The guests are filling into your father's long house, your long house. The Tain enter first, each trailing a modest group of warriors. Your mother leans in to whisper a few words of advice before she takes her seat. You should greet each of the Tain before the feast begins, but listen well to their words. Few of them would benefit from making this a smooth transition. It will be important to know where they stand. Alright, so I might want to disable that, but we can speak to the guy which has a name which is written that badly here, so we'll need to go for all of them. It is not mandatory, but it is better if you want to actually understand the story well. So we are going to pay our respect to all of these guys. So we are going to begin with our brother, Rurik. So your elder brother Rurik always had a penchant for music. He looks up and gives you a warm smile as you approach him. Godfeld, brother, Rurik grins. I mean my honored Tain, how do you feel? So, there is a lot of choice in this game and plenty which matters. And it's really really enjoyable to be able to solve situations in a wide array of different solutions. So, let's say I'm Rurik, I know our father is involved now. I'm going to go with the third one, it seems to be the most... I don't think it's quite sunk in yet that father is gone. Rick plays and gingerly on your shoulder. You can barely hear his soft voice over the din of the feast. Father was a warrior. There is no doubt he is feasting with Odin. Now, I'm sorry I couldn't be the older brother I was expected to be. You don't deserve to deal with the mess on your own. Let's say, don't worry, I'm proud to take father's place. So your brother Flash, you a cheeky grin. You should be. I know you'll be a better leader to the clan than he was. Now go and be a good host. We'll talk later. Alright, let's just now discover the other guest. We've got Skull Cleaver here. Which is a pretty intimidating name. So Skull Cleaver is a Tain of Jelling, which border your area. Jelling is a large territory and Skull is one of the most powerful Tain in Jutland. Jelling has prospered under his rule. Skull pushed himself away from the table with his foot, the chair making a grinding sound across the wooden floor. His face shows earnest sympathy. Ragnar, my boy, so sorry about your father. If there is anything the people of Jelling can do to aid you in these trying times, don't hesitate to ask. Let's just say, that's very kind of you, Tain Skull. Of course, we must all stand together against the Frankish threat. Skull leaned towards you, resting his elbow on the table. Tell me, what are your plans for this place? How will you lead your clan? So, let's say... I'm going to say I'll start by expanding our defense. You really are another son, are you? Just take care not to lose touch of your people's needs in eagerness to defend them. He let out a deep sigh and leaned back into his seat. I'm sure you know I fought with your father many years ago. We were very much of a similar inclination, he and I. That man had a real taste for battle, not like his brother. Mark my words, Ragnar. True bond are forged in battle, not bound in blood. He came to me for advice before he mounted his last journey, on account of my tie with Copang. I should have warned him better about what he was getting himself into. Let's say, what does Copang have to do with it? Viking out of Copang, I've been to the isle across the sea. I've heard many stories about it. Since I often go there to trade, your father wanted to hear if the story were true. Ah, but I've taken too much of your time already. I know you have other guests to entertain. Perhaps we'll talk later, after a bit of mead. Skull nods more to himself than you, and turns his attention to the food on the table. Okay, let's just speak to Aldanre, Samuel Dawson. So, Alfdanr, it's really difficult, I don't really know if I'm going to pronounce that well, is a Thane of a slightly larger clan that border your land to the east. He wears a solemn expression and nods heavily when you approach him. Nador is in Valhall now, Ragnar. There is no doubt about it. He died doing what he loved. But while the feast amounts the hero, you are left here to sort out the pieces. You've got your work cut out for you. What do you mean? Your father managed to make quite a few enemies in his time, most of them amongst his own clan. If you permit me to be honest, he never paid one speck of attention to the wish or needs of his people. Surely you are not expecting your claim to leadership to go unconsidered. Let's say no one in this clan is more suited to lead than I. I'll win them over. Well, shit, let's hope you're right. At least it's plain for all to see you through a bloody fine feast. Alfdanr emptied his mug of mead in a single gulp, then slammed the mug onto the table and called to a trial for a refill. Okay, let's go now with Ketil, my best friend, I think. I'm pretty sure about that, as a matter of fact. Ketil is standing off to the side, holding a horn full of mead. The young archer appeared to be watching the feast with thankful amused expression, and he nods respectfully when you come near. Berzian entering your guest? Let's say... not too busy to check in on you, or as busy as you'd expect. Ketil wink conspirationally, trying to decide who to pick a fight with. I want this feast to be memorable, but nobody tells a story about feast without a fight. Joke aside, have you seen Skull Askald? Askald's over there in the corner. Oh no. Shradgaida and Skaki, I've heard a story about them. Nevja seems to be expecting trouble too, so I've decided to go easy on the mead and keep an eye out. So, I appreciate that. It never hurts to be careful. He threw his head back slightly toward Aslerf. Speaking of which, keep an eye on the big lug back there, and he and his friend have been putting their head together all night. I think he might be planning something. So let's just say Aslerf's family wouldn't attack me. Ketil raised an eyebrow. Sure, he wouldn't do anything underhanded, but it is basically tradition for our family to fight over who gets to sit in the big chair. But this is your feast. I'll watch Aslerf and his friend. You should relax and enjoy yourself. Alright, let's just speak now to Aslerf. No idea. Aslerf is a distant cousin. Leadership of the clan has moved between your side of the family and his for a generation. He is known as a skilled warrior and a hard worker. Aslerf sits with his two closest friends.
Our condolences on the passing of your father. At least he died the way he would have wanted. He will be feasting with the gods tonight.
Some character are voiced over. I'm just going to continue. Thank you. Let's say we're going to go for a second. It's not as friendly, but it is probably more bland here. So there is no need for pretense. You never respected my father. I will not ask you that you begin now. Aslerf seems to consider this for a while before replying. It's no secret, I didn't agree with how Nador ruled our clan. Bearing this in mind, I don't see what gives you the right to succeed him, but this feast is in his honor, and I will not insult his memory here, nor will I challenge your claim to leadership. So you believe you would be more suited to lead us? I do. Let's say... So you are wrong. I hope you will give me a chance to prove it. Aslerf not simply nods once, then he returns his attention to his companion. Okay, let's go for the last one. Ragnhild the White. So Ragnhild the White is the most influential of your guests. As a vassal of the king Sigurd Yngre, she is the current ruler of Denmark. She has come from the trade hub of Frib to the south, where she presides as Jarl. She nods politely as you approach her seat. It was a beautiful ceremony, Ragnar. I extend my condolences for your loss on behalf of Ribe and of the king. I must tell you, I advise him not to seek out the isle across the sea. We've all heard the story of the unprotected coast and their treasure, but there is more danger than the rumor lets on. I am not surprised they claimed his life, but I am glad at least he died with a sword in his hand. So let's just go for a second one. Thank you for accepting the invitation. We are honored that you could make it. Of course, your father's sword will be missed in our struggle against the Franks. Did you know Nador well? I knew him as a warrior. We fought together on the Bravellir, and he struck me as a shrewd tactician. When your king needs you, I hope that you will serve him as well as your father did. Let's say I will serve. You have my word, or we could go with something a bit less tiding. I'm just going to go with my father taught me everything he knew about combat. Jarl Ragnall nodded once. I would expect nothing less of the man, but remember that no amount of practice is a substitute for actual experience. So if you excuse me, I must do the round, enter the feast. The old chill maiden smiled. She gracefully slid back down into his seat, whereupon she spears a large piece of chicken with her knife and dump it on her plate. Okay, we just need to speak to Nevja, our other closest friend, and we'll be good for this
there
little
you
part.
Are. The feast seems to be off to a good start.
So Nevja is one of your oldest friends, your family have always been close, and you grew up together in the village. She just finished pouring your mother a mug of mead. So, let's go for the second one. Are you being the tram? Yeah, we're going to go for the first one. It's nice to see you. So you've seen my sister in his dress before, surely that's the same thing. Yeah, she has a twin sister. She closed her eyes. Not sure it's a twin. I think she might be a bit younger, but she's really looking alike. Anyway, let's continue. God, she was so excited to see me like this. I'll never hear the end of it. So where is Aethura? My poor sister has a fever again. She has such a frail constitution. All this wet cold is hard on her. Mother stayed at home to take care of her. So what do you think of our guest? Your fellow Tain are certainly a proud and graceful bunch, even as they plot to murder you and take your lands. That's certainly the sense I'm getting. Or I'm sure not all of them are actively planning to kill us. I have a weird feeling about Skull though. I doubt they call him Skull Cleaver for no reason. Alvdan plays a lovable old Gramp, but I know he had his eyes on our Elba for years. Ragnhild, I'm not sure about. She probably has nothing to gain from destroying us, but she's little more than Sigurd Inger Appendage, and who knows where he stands. Okay, let's talk later. I had to be a good host. And good luck and watch your back. Okay, we just need to go to our seat and finish the feast. So following the initial meet and greet, everyone toast to your father and dig into the meal. Food cover every inch of the table and the freshly brewed mead seems to flow endlessly. Okay, you're listening to Nevja usually complain about her mother when cattle perk up and slip discreetly out of the longhouse. Outside, some piece of pottery crash against the ground and the men begin to shout. In short order, the door flies open and the doorway is filled with by Ota Erling's son, sword in hand. Outside, you see his brother standing over the prone form of Ketil. Ota look around the room with disgust. What a splendid feast for such a shit Thane. Ota gaze stop on you. He raises sword to point at you accusingly. Ragnar, your family had a chance to earn our respect and you wasted it. Come outside and defend your honor, or we will burn this all to the ground. Nevja jumped to her feet, already holding her knife. Her voice seems with disgust. Ota, you miserable drunkard. How dare you attack your Thane honor during his own feast. Your family will pay for this. Ota has turned his back on you and is already walking back outside. All the other guests turn their gaze to you in anticipation. Your mother leans in to whisper in your ear. You have to handle this. If the other Danes think we are too weak to deal with such a blow against our family's honor. So let's just go for that. Never just stay here, I'll handle these, Nidhoggar. The drunken fool is here for a fight. I think we'll actually have to kill him this time. Alright, so let's just pick up our weapons and we're going to go for the first fight. I like the way the game begins because it's giving you a good sense of what's happening in this little town and what you need to worry about. So let's get all this thing. We're going to take a look at the equipment here. So we've got a few things to equip. We've got a bow, which is going to be our primary weapon as we've been going for Hunter. I also need to equip a shield and knife in case. I think Nevja has all his gear set up already, yes. So I cannot say his inventory is amazing. It is working, but it is not always that easy to... Let's say it's not fancy. It's not fancy. It's working fine, but it is not fancy. Nonetheless, let's go for this first fight. Alright, so most of the guests follow you outside and form alpha circle behind you. You're dimly aware of the other Thane muttering among themselves. Nevja ran over Ketil to help him back on his feet. A streak of blood ran from his hair down his cheek, but it looked like he can still fight. Four against one, this is what the son of Elgin Torgilsson considered a fair fight. Ottar, brother, just sneer, his own drank. Shut your mouth, woman, he started it. So, let's see. Let's go with the third one, I think. Or I could go with the last one. Does your father know your hair destroying his name? Ottar shifts his weight restlessly as he regards the Thane assembled behind you. He does not, but he will be proud of us when Aslaug is finally our Thane instead of you. Aslefru. I don't really know how to pronounce that. You've gone too far, Ottar. This is no honor. There is no honor in this. I must take Ragnar's side here. For a moment, confusion mixed with fright in Ottar's eyes, but he quickly composed himself. Fine, we'll kill you all. Then I'll be Thane. Okay, so we've got our first fight here. So basically, it's working like, let's say, modern tactical are working. We've got 2 points. We've got 1 point to attack and 1 point to move. And for some attack, we can actually spend both points to make something a bit more efficient. So I've got probably, let's see, I should have 2 bowmen here, 1 spear woman, and a shield bearer. So they've got 1 brawler, 1. It's some kind of warrior, but he could be having a shield, but he has none. We've got also some kind of cleric here, a healer, and a bowman here. So it is important to notice that bowmen are very deadly in this game, so you need to take them out very, very quick. So we've got that guy here, and I cannot shoot him here. He's undercover, so we are going to be using a bunch of skills to make this possible. So, or I could go for these first. You can choose whatever character you want to use at whatever time you want. And you can also, let's say I want to move with one character and I can switch to another one and come back to the previous one so I can use the attack. There is no importance in the order in which you are going to use your character. So we are not going to spend too much time on this battle. It's a fairly easy one. I'm going to send probably my buddy here, Aslef here, to prevent that guy from moving. Alright. And I'm going to... I could wait for him. I could just... I'm going to try to stun him. It's going to be more efficient if he cannot move. Ah! I should deactivate the help. It's going to take a lot of space of the screen. So the advantage of the spear is that we're not going to be going too close to the enemy. We can just attack them from here. So we're going to just do it that way. And I could maybe use one of my bowmen to finish that one. I could. I've got a fairly good chance to do it, and as you can see, there is an attack of opportunity which is written in red here. So if I was close, I'll just take that guy. You see there is a little arrow here which is telling you that if I move here, this guy is going to attack me, and it is important to be careful because it is basically a free attack for the enemy, so you don't want to let them do these. So let's just begin by shooting that guy. You can very well just attack before you move. There is no... it is not important if you don't follow the, if you don't move before you attack. It is also true for the, let's say there is some kind of thing which are like Overwatch, it's going to interrupt is going to be an action you are going to initiate in your turn. If they move towards you while they are playing, you are going to be able to shoot them. And you can do this action and just move afterwards, it's not going to be an issue. Okay, let's just see, I'm going to use this little attack here, which is basically a free action, but you've got only one per combat. There is little dots over there to say how much time you're going to be able to use these. So with this one I can actually shoot that guy, and it's going to remove the cover. So it is quite powerful. So I will be able to normally shoot him with my buddy Ketil here. Maybe not that well. Maybe the cover is too good. Oh yes, it's a full cover, so it's not going to work. But if it was an alpha cover, I could have used this skill to make him raise and shoot him. Okay, so who do I want to shoot? Might want to go for that guy instead. I'm going to go with quick shot. It is going to be a little bit less accurate, but I will be able to shoot twice, so it might be worth it. Okay, one has been eating, and let's go for the second one. Maybe it's going to work. Yes, good. As I was saying, bowmen are very powerful in this game. And then we'll just need to maybe move a bit closer. I could just focus now. I'm going to just wait here. I'm going to wait for them to come closer. Alright. So this effect is quite perfect. It's going to halve your chance of... let's just go with that. This one is... Oh, I forgot something very... Oh, it's not really such of a big deal, but it is something we need to speak about. So this is something which is really unusual in this kind of game. We've got this little button here, which is going to toggle non-lethal attack and lethal attack. So you can do fight without killing anybody. It's going to have sometime an influence on the scenario. It is really... I should have done that if I wanted to not kill all these guys, so we don't really have such of an issue with the family. I could have just clicked on that. I would not have killed any of these, and it would have been much more efficient, because I think I killed somebody here. So it is something which is quite unusual, and it is really, really cool to be able to do it. It's going to change the way you're going to handle quests sometime. Anyway, let's just finish this fight before I get too spread in the way I'm just trying to explain things. Because it is difficult to just think about the fighting and just comment it. So let's just go. I want to shoot the bowman first, so we're going to take care of him right away. And I missed. Not cool. I might want to go for a quick shot. It might work. Okay, one time, good. Let's try to maybe. Please. Okay, good. He's down. And as you can see, he has been incapacitated. So he's not dead. And this is something which is going to happen for your character as well. So you will be able to raise after a fight. Okay, so I'm going to use my spear. This is very handy because you can use the spear over cover. So it is quite powerful. I'm going to send my buddy here. We are not going to be able to finish him, but still. The only drawback with non-lethal attack is that you don't do critical anymore. So it's going to reduce your ability to defeat your enemy quickly. Alright. So did I kill any of these? I think so. I killed one. And this injury, it is from before the fight, but there is a system of injury which is quite interesting. So when you have a character which is down in a combat, the more time is spent down, the more chance there is that he's going to get injuries. Injuries which are going to be quite crippling if you just stack them, so you don't want to let them on the ground too long. There is a skill which is going to enable you to help your character which are down on the ground in the combat, but it's going to be a skill which is going to be quite high level, so you don't really use it at first. So the best way to not get injury is to end the fight quickly at the beginning. Alright, so Ottar and Langsan groans as he tried to sit up on the frozen earth. Ketil walk over to the soundly defeated farmer and kick his weapon away. Ottar's surviving brothers are slowly getting to their feet as well. None of them has any fight left in them. You see, it's telling you surviving brother, but if I had not killed any, it would be different, and if I had killed them all, it would be again different. So there is plenty of way to change the way you are going to make the scenario work. So I'm not going to execute, I'm just going to let them leave. So the brothers pick up their weapon and leave gently. Their pride has suffered a tremendous blow tonight, and this is not likely to be the last you've heard of it. Your guests look on with a solemn expression that don't reveal what they think of this act of mercy. So let's see, we're going to go. Anyone who has dispute with me can observe our custom and challenge me to a duel, but I will not be ambushed at my own feast. I step forward. I look not the least bit tired from the fight. I support you here tonight because Ottar and his brother were out of line. It is not the way of our clan to kill each other in drunken brawls. Ragnar, son of Naldo, I challenge you to a duel for a position of Thane. An excited murmur rises among the guests. Ketil mutter in a voice too low for anyone other than you and Nevjad to hear. Can you believe this, Pictisondr? It's his right to issue such a challenge. His timing could be better, though. Let's just go with Atle, son of Grimvard. I accept your challenge. We will meet on Olmgang Island at noon on the morrow. May the gods favor you. Alright. I think we are going to now. I'm not going to go much further into the storyline. I don't want to show much more. But it is. There is already something here. It is just dragging you forward. It is quite compelling. I like the way the storyline is just unfolding. We are just going to switch to my other save so I can just show you a bit more, maybe a bit more combat and a bit more of the world, and also a little bit of how we build things. It is a pretty light management thing, but it is also important to show it. So let's just load my other save. Alright, so we are a bit further into the storyline. I've got my Band of War, which is behind us, and we are in our village here. So I'm going to show you a bit of the management. So it is, as I was saying, fairly light, but we've got a bunch of resources down there, which we are going to be able to use for plenty of things. So basically the will is going to be to build these things, these let's say options, because we've got trees which we are not going to be able to follow on both sides. We need to choose in which way we are going to go. So let's say I'm going to check with the blacksmith, so I can go for, let's say, armor or for weapon craft, for craftsman, and it's not going to give me the same options. So we've got a bunch of things like this, but it is fairly light. There is no management for the resource. They are not going to burn your resource. They can give you some. Let's say, I think there is, where was it? Strange. I'm missing something here. I don't see it. It's probably here, but I don't see it. Oh, is this one? Yes, it is this one. So the more. Yeah, we can go for sacrificial bog, which is going to give you ration weekly, or an herbal glade, which is going to give you herbs. So one is going to enable you to heal yourself, and the second one is going to enable you to feed yourself. So we've got little choice here to do, and each of these are going to take a bit of time. The time is running when you are going to be in the overworld, and I will show you that just a little bit later. So basically this location are going to be the place where you're going to get your quest, you're going to be able to talk to people, you're going to be able to loot things, and you're going to be able to trade here. So we are going to go a bit on the map because I want to show you something else. I want to show you how the camping mechanic works, because it is quite an important mechanic of the game. So I think I might want to show you a bit of the other things. So we've got the inventory here. As I was saying, it's not that clear. It is working fine, but it's not that clear. We've got our skill panel here, with all the thing I was speaking about earlier. We'll just take a look at these. So as we are going to go and see the camping mechanics, we are going to probably, I don't know if I can consult these in the camping interface. I'm really not sure. Anyway, we've got all the things which are going to be helpful, but I might want to show that when we are going to be done with the camping, if I cannot do while we are doing it. Anyway, let's just keep going. So we've got a quest log here. We've got a codex, which is going to give you a hint on how is your relationship with different tribes, and a timeline, because there is often a time limit for the quest, which is increasingly generous, though. So it's not really an issue. I'm almost done with this quest, and I'm there. So I've got quite a bit of time to finish it. I can wander around for a long time if I want to. Anyway, let's just go to the side of the map here, and we're going to go on the map, on the bigger map, so I can show you a bit of camping. So we've got a bunch of location here. So the little one here are the camp, are the place you can camp. This one is occupied, so I could show you a fight as I'm going to show you the camping. But we've got also a bigger location which are going to be important for the quest. So let's say we are in the north here. We've got a few towns like Skernig, we've got Reeb, and basically it is the land of the first quest. When we're going to be ready, we're going to leave for the British Islands, which are going to be also interesting to discover. But for now, let's just focus on the camping. So basically, when we're going to go over there, some are occupied, some are not. These are, so we're going to go for this one. We're going to fight a bunch of enemies, and we're going to be able to camp then. So we're going to choose a bunch of character. Basically, all these are the one which are pre-made. These are going to be character with storyline, and I've been making a few more. This one is also a character which is which has a storyline. I've got three more which I've been building. Nonetheless, let's go and fight this fight. I don't know what we're going to find. It could be wolf, it could be bandits. It's going to be a surprise. It is important to notice that wolves are more dangerous than you think. They can do quite a lot of damage. Okay, so let's see. Oh, we got bandits. Okay, it will be fine also. So I've got a team which is a little bit more powerful. We've got two guys with shield, even though one is better than the others. We've got two bowmen, a spearwoman, and a cleric, a witch. So let's go. I'm going to bring a few people to the front line. Let's bring my shield bearer here. I'm going to also bring my spearwoman here. We've got only half cover here, but it should be alright. And I'm going to bring my other shield bearer over there. And then it's going to be time for my bowman to begin to do a bit of damage. I might want to move my witch as well. Over there? Maybe here. I need her to be close to the combat, because I think in this team it might be the only one which is going to be able to heal my other character. She's got 3 heal per fight, so it's not that much, but she's enough to keep us alive, I believe. Okay, so let's just take a look. I'm going to shoot. So what do we have here? I might want to... I cannot shoot this guy. It's a shame, because it is always important to shoot the guy which are going to be able to heal or buff these enemies. But I might want to begin with this one, because he's... Oh. Nah. Okay, I don't really have so much chance, so I might want to go for a named shot, which is going to give me a lot more chance to success. So this one is going to be costing me my 2 points, so I cannot move when I'm going to use this one. But it's going to increase my chance of hitting the enemy a lot. Okay, let's go for that. Okay. I'm not even sure it's going to be sufficient, so I might want to go and try to shoot twice. Nah, I won't get him. It is going to decrease too much. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to go a little bit closer maybe. Nah, am I fine here? Let's get into cover here. I'm going to just use a regular shot. It might not get him, but at least the healer are going to get a bit closer, which is good for us. Okay, so it's going to be in our light, in our line of sight, so we might be able to focus the guy. We've got two guys with spears. Okay, so he's been using the favor of Tyr, which I think is increasing the ability to damage me. Okay, so the blue bar you can see up there, health bar, is the let's say the resilience of the shield. When there is no more, they cannot use it anymore. Okay, so I might want to shoot the healer first. So I'm going to go for a two aimed shot. Once again. And hopefully it will be enough to finish the job. Nah, not really, but I'm going to just try to go with somebody else and... Oh, I forgot something important. My healer is also going to use a slingshot, so she might be able to finish him. Meanwhile, let's see what I can do. That guy is going to attack us from behind, I believe. So I'm going to use that guy to maybe... There is no shield here, so... I could move him away and move toward that guy. Yes, we're going to do that. I'm just going to kick him. He's going to move backward. And he won't be able to use his attack of opportunity against me. And then I'm going to move... over there. And it would be nice if I was able to bring my shield bearer on this side to flank the guy. You see, I'm going to do a lot more damage if I flank the guy with another guy. Okay, I'm going to bring... Let's say I need to move my witch. I'm going to move her here, so she's going to be in cover. Can I shoot that guy? Yeah, I can. But I've got 43% chance, which is not that much. It might be better to just heal the other guy.
I can fix this.
Alright.
Very good.
And then if I'm lucky, I think I might be attacked. Yes, I'm going to be. So I'm just going to come here. And we're going to try to stun the guy. Ah, good. So he won't be able to act on the next turn. Then, I'm going to bring... where could I go? I'm going to bring the spear here, I think. And I could try to... get that guy? Yes, let's go for that. I'm going to try to focus a bit so we can finish the guy quickly. And I think we should be done for this turn. Okay, it was not a very good healing, but they cannot heal themselves. So the healer is not going to be able to regen if there is no other healer. Okay, not good. Who are they going to shoot? Nobody, good. Alright, good. I need to finish the healer quickly, or maybe the other one is going to heal him. Let's just use another aim shot to finish that one. Alright. I might want to use the witch to... there is a debuff here, which is very, very powerful. Demoralize. I'm going to use him. Alright. I might want to attack that guy. Or I could remove his shield and try to shoot him with a second bowman. I might want to do that. Because... Shieldbearer are really, really good against bowmen. They are able to handle plenty of shots before anything happen. Oh, I cannot shoot him, but you know what? I'm going to use the fire arrow, which is a very powerful skill you can use only one time in a combat, to put him on fire. So he might die anyway. And I missed. Okay, so he might not. So we're going to try to do it differently. I'm going to use... Spearwoman to damage him quite a lot, and then we're going to use my Shieldbearer to kill him. Good. Then, what do we have? I don't think I've got any point left. I could also maybe... no, I've got nothing here. Nothing left, let's just call it a turn. I'm not doing a lot of damage. I don't think they are high level enough. Ouch. But if you fight enemy which are of the same strength, they are going to do a lot of damage and you don't want to let them shoot you too much. Let's say I'm on easy mode right now, kind of. So I definitely want to shoot this guy. I'm not going for a quick shot because I'm not going to be able to shoot them. I will just miss. It's not going to be very efficient. Alright, so the aim shot is also increasing the chance to make a critical shot. So do we have anybody which is, let's say, sensitive? I might want to focus on that guy, but I would also want to flank him. It's not going to happen. So let's just use... Oh, I might want to do a little bit of healing here.
Need a hand? Thank you.
Alright. And I'm going to use... Oh yes, I think I'm going to do that. Let's just use Nevja. She's going to be able to do something very useful. She's going to use a fend to go behind the enemy. So let's just do it this way. It's very handy to flank an enemy. The thing is, I'm not going to be able to bring Gunnar here. He will be attacked. I could just do it to show you how these attack of opportunity work. Alright, I'm getting it. And so we've got the flanked status, so it's going to enable me to do a lot more damage. Let's just do it. And luckily it was a critic, so done. No more. Meanwhile, I'm going to try to stun that guy. Done. And I think we might be able to end this fight. Maybe not the next turn, but not far.
You bastard!
Okay. There is also area on the map which you can, let's say, there are areas which are going to be slippery, so you can just fall. There are areas with bushes which are going to prevent you from advancing too fast. There is plenty of interesting things which are going to happen on the map. Meanwhile, who do we have to shoot here? That guy would be nice. Then we'll need to focus maybe on the bowman because he's going to run around quite a bit. What do we have left? I could finish this guy and... Nah. Let's see, do I have a line of sight on this one? The bowmen are able to shoot from very far. It is really, really nice. Even further than that. Okay, so... Yes, let's just kill him quick. It's not going to be enough. Oh, yes it is. Good. So we can now move Nevja towards that guy. It's going to be... I'm just going to rush. And I might be able to shoot him from here. Yes, but I've got very little chance to be able to do that. There's one skill which is very fun with that character. I've got a puffball here, which is basically generating a cover. I might want to just use it here. So Nevja don't get shot. So it is... a smoke screen which is going to prevent enemy from attacking your character. It is quite powerful. It is also going to prevent you from shooting things if it is in the way, but still. It is a nice killer. Oh, he's going to shoot somebody else. Yeah, not a bad choice. Let's just shoot him again. It's not going to last long. I've got two bowmen which are going to be able to do pretty much the same thing, so here it goes. So it's working very well. The combat system is quite compelling. I like it. It's a very, let's say, it's pretty classical, but it is working very, very well. So we're going to be able to use this camp mechanic. So basically it's a bit complicated, but you've got four shifts. If you don't, there is one skill which is going to reduce that, but you need to sleep for two shifts for each character. If you are not able to do it, you are going to have a fatigated effect, which is deadly. It is going to remove a few points from your stat, and it is really something you don't want to have. So you always want to have your character which are going to be rested, well rested. And what you are going to do with your other shift is going to be depending on your character skills. So you need to guard the place. You cannot camp without paying attention to what's going to happen. Because if you don't get a good let's say a good shift of guard, which are going to protect the camp, you are going to lose materials, and it is not something you want. And each character is going to be able to do different things depending on their skill. Can I access these? Yes, I can. Amazing, good. Let's just take a look. So we've got the utility skills. So basically, let's say I'm going to take that character. So that character is my cook. So I've got skills which are going to give me... I might want to come in to begin with the first one. So let's say Ketil. Ketil is my hunter. So I've got... Oh, maybe not at that point in the game, but he might be my hunter at some point. So he has 2 points in hunting. It's going to allow him to bring me 3 to 5 meats. I might even want to increase that. Let's just say that for the good. So 5 to 6 now. So it's going to allow him to bring me meat, which we are going to be able to then convert into ration with Adis. Thanks to her skill, she's going to be able to convert 4 meat into a ration, and so on. It's going to enable you to harvest resource from these camps. You will also be able to repair your gear. You will be able to tinker to make items to use in combats. You will be able to craft your own weapons, and all of these in these camps. So depending on your on the skill on your character, you are going to be able to do plenty on these. And let's see. And you will also be able to heal the injuries of your character. So let's say Rough Sky is going to be able to use we cannot do that because there is nobody which is injured, but if we had somebody which had an injury, you would be able to use one of these shifts to remove it. So quite useful. And we've got here a reminder of what you can do, or what you need to do. So as I don't have enough people which are going to preserve the meal, the meat, I'm going to lose a bunch. So let's say I want to make just preserve this, and we're going to lose 0 meat, better. And I've got a helmet here which is in bad shape, so I could ask Aslef, which is probably my crafter, let's say my repairer, to fix it. It's going to cost me a little bit of hide, but I will be able to repair that. See, so this is really an important mechanic of the game. Anyway, let's go. Let's just make camp, and we are going to see what's going to happen. So we are going to be able to see the shift. I really find it to be very, very cool. Even though we don't really see the log, which I bring on the left side, there is a little result here, which is going to tell you what you've been doing and how it's happening here. Okay, so we are done with this camp here. Alright, so... in this camp I was also doing a bit of scouting, so I've been discovering a few areas here which are going to be over there. These are going to just be a little bit of... oh, we've got an event. So when you are going to navigate through the map, you often stumble upon events which are going to give you, let's say, which are going to yield different kind of results. Sometimes they are not going to yield anything. So the acrid stench of smoke draw your attention to a tree off the side of the pass, 100 pace uphill. It smoulders still, the trunk blackened and split in twain by the force of a lightning bolt. Oh, okay, I know this one. Struck by a tall lightning, this place been touched by the god Sphinx. So depending on what you are going to do, it's going to change a bit the relation between your character. We would do well to leave an offering and seek allowing from the loud rider. So let's just approach the tree. What was once a stout oak tree now stands split apart, as so a great force burst from within it. In the jagged wand, you see wood turned into charcoal and the dust in white ash. Amber still burns at the heart of it. Such a majesty and awesome power. What manner of offering should we make? So I'm going to give them 10 valuable. You place a piece of fine silver among the twisted roots of the tree. It glitters in stark contrast to the dark wood. As you turn to leave, a shrill cow draws your attention. A pair of crow perch among the ruined branch. One of them stares pointedly at you with black inscrutable eyes. Roskvar smiles and makes a sight of the armor. The old feather recognizes our devotion to his kin. And now we should have gained, yes, we've got, at the top left there is all follower have gained morale. So it's going to be showed over there. You've got a loyal thing here. So depending on the threats, so Rothgar is cunning, so that's just greedy and independent. Depending on these, what you are going to do is going to influence loyalty. So not all the characters are going to be as loyal. Let's say Aslef is not really, he's still hesitant here. Anyway, I think we've been seeing what we were, just going to take these. So, 6 wood, as you can see, got a bit more here with more wood and more wood. Anyway, so I'm going to just take my last save and we're going to go and check a little bit of the British Islands with my Drakkar. Alright, so in this part we're about to leave for the British Islands. I'm not sure we're going to go very far on this because we are running out of time, but I just want to show you when we're going to arrive in this coast. So we're just going to leave. I believe we might get anchored there on these. I'm not sure. I did not see any yet, but we're going to cross this water and we're going to land on the beach of the British coast here. So we're going to choose a bench. Alright. And let's see how our raid is going to begin. It is not obligated to go and raid these lands. I believe when you are going to build your Drakkar, you are going to be able to choose if you want to have a hull which is going to be for speed, for let's say for cargo hold, to be intimidating. So depending on what you choose, you might be able to do different things. The man and woman watch you disembark from the rock above, silhouette against a light grey sky. Down the beach, two brave youngsters keep a close eye on the mysterious stranger and their imposing warship. Navja boots sink into the sand as you jump as a few feet from the ship, weapon in hand. I see a path up the cliff to the south, they'll be expecting us. Gunnar grips his axe, clearly pleased to feel its weight in his hand. No, they know we're coming, but they won't be expecting us. Ketil stagger as he feels the firm ground sway beneath him after days of sailing. Shading his eyes with his hand, he looks up at the stone building that tower above the cliff. If we come for riches, I'd say we found it. Look at that fortress. If the plan is to attack that hall, I hope this coast is as undefended as the Remor made it out to be. A king who can afford a building like that can also afford to retain warrior to protect it. Rosvar speak barely loud enough to hear over the roar of the surf. It's not a fortress, I think. It has an air of sanctity about it. I could be wrong, but Edis is already tossing sacks of supply on the beach, making ready to establish a camp. Getting ahead of yourself, sweethearts. Smoke didn't come from that building. There is a village above this cliff. Should go say hi. We're gonna scout things, the rest of you drag up the ship and make the camp. So, this is approximately where I think the big adventure begins for this team of Vikings. But we are going to stop here, I don't want to show too much. Still, I like this little moment. So guys, I hope you like the video. If you do, please leave a like, a comment or subscribe, and I'll see you next time, guys. Have fun!